Happy Sabbath. You know, I haven't been back in this area in quite some time. I actually lived here for about 9 years. And we lived over in Hendersonville, or Mountain Home, I believe, and went to the Hendersonville Seventh-day Adventist Church. My father was a publishing director, assistant publishing director in this area for those 9 years, and worked with many of the literary evangelists throughout this vast area, from Greenville, Spartanburg, to Silva, I mean, you name it. He was all over. So I recognize a few things as I'm driving back here, and in the late 90s is when my father retired and moved back up to Virginia. And so as I was at Southern College, now Southern University, it wasn't very far. You know, growing up, I've always been Adventist. I've always been vegetarian. I never smoked, never drank, never did what we know we shouldn't do. And growing up in an Adventist home, you know, one side was many generations, the other not quite so many, but I think 5 generations on one and 4 on the other. I thought I had it figured out. You know, I never dated. I tried. I looked very young for my age. And I would always get turned down or, you know, oh, we're just friends, you know, all that. I never knew that God would lead me to Korea to be a missionary and find my wife. Ever since I was a young child, I would pray, Lord, wherever my wife is, because, you know, when you get jilted and you're like, oh, she doesn't like me, well, Lord, wherever my wife is, I mean, I'm young, praying for my future wife, wherever she is, to be with her. And after we met, my wife said, you know, there were times where she was hit by a car and flew like 30-some feet. She shouldn't be here. But yet she prayed. Her neighbor actually was a pastor, and she was friends with the daughter. And so she went to church with them sometimes, and she saw how the father was at home compared with at church. And it made her heart, Lord, I want to know the truth. I want to go to the right church. But she knew that that was not, that there was some, you know, issues there. And when she looks back, now she knows how God had led and how my prayers were answered. So growing up, I wasn't a bad kid. I was a very, you know, in my heart. And we know, now I know, the Bible tells us the heart is deceitful and above all things cannot be trusted. Who can know but God? Amen. So we can convince ourselves of these things. Well, it's not too bad. Well, yeah, the spirit of prophecy says this, but you know what I'm talking about. All of us have dealt with that. So when I got the call to come to the Southern Union in 2010, I had been trained as a medical missionary. I was an evangelist where I would go into churches, Baptist church, Adventist churches, didn't matter, and I would present week-long seminars, reversing, you name it. I mean, we've seen everything to where, unfortunately, we get many of the cases where they are, the medical community has given up on them. In other words, had one gentleman, he had a PSA of 704, could not walk, 60s, they sent him home. They couldn't do chemo, they couldn't do radiation. And he found out about us, in 30 days he was walking, and his PSA had dropped to 335. 30 more days, it was down to 35, he was doing everything as normal. 50 days later, he was totally done. What man gives up on, God does not.
Amen.
We used the spirit of prophecy. So I have seen over and over how the spirit of prophecy brings healing in that case. When I got to the Southern Union, I was gung-ho. I mean, you know, when I'm going to churches and presenting the health message and showing them this is inspired of God. I mean, in a Baptist church, and afterward they wanted to come up and touch that book. They wanted to see it. Our message is for this time. As I was at the Southern Union, I found more and more. The Lord opens doors as you see fit. You know, there's, what does it say? If you reject light, there's no more light that is given. So as you accept that light, as you accept the promises that God has given us, you know, you heard my brother Joseph, he said, it is the testimony of Jesus. I want to ask you a question. The Holy Spirit that inspired the prophets of the Bible and all of the writers of the Bible, is that the same Holy Spirit that inspired Ellen White?
Yes.
You hear of, yes, she's the lesser light, right? You've heard this. I want to give you a homework assignment. Go into the writings, search them, find all that she says about lesser light. Then look at what are comments that were added. You'll find something. The lesser light. Yes, she was a lesser light. But also, the Bible was referred to as the lesser light, pointing to the great light, which is Christ.
Amen.
So when you hear that quote, go back and look where it's coming from. If it's a comment, or if it is, you understand what I'm saying. So it's a study there. I believe, and I have proved, every time there was a quote that had some difficulty, well, I don't know if that's really in the Bible. It might take some time, but you can prove. Everyone here is a Seventh-day Adventist, right? Okay. Does everyone know who Ellen White is? Who does not know? Well, are you aware of anyone that might not know in this room? Okay. The Bible is very clear on the test of a prophet. Okay? The prophet cannot prophesy and be found wrong, then they're not a true prophet.
Amen.
Okay? I sat down with a baptized Seventh-day Adventist who had been baptized for about 8 years, but would not read, well, actually did read some, but just put it away. The spirit of prophecy. Only wanted the Bible. God gave the doctor that I work with in our consultations, he had a health issue. God gave us the opportunity. He allowed that divine appointment to where we could witness to this man. I can give you 50 proven prophetic answers where she said about education, okay? And it is proven now that what she said is correct.
Amen.
Okay, so there's 50 right off there. Barnum Research, you know who Barnum Research? Basically, you go down through there. She told us all of that. Okay? Probably in the health message, I can give about 50. For example, she said that grains should be cooked several hours that are used in porridge or mush. What's porridge? What's mush? It's basically grain cooked in water. Okay? Well, why would she say that? Well, they found out about 10 years ago, well, maybe 12 now, that undercooked starches in grains cause scars on the lacunae region of the brain, which is the frontal lobe of the brain. They call them lacunae scars. Those scars cause TIAs, or mini strokes. Okay? Proven. Okay, I'm just giving you one. We actually had a gentleman down in the islands, he was having mini strokes every 2 or 3 days. Eating healthy, exercising, everything, mini strokes. Sat down with him, found out that he was having a smoothie in the morning, and he would put some oats in it. So we told him how to dextrinize his oats. Well, you'll ask me that. 200 temperature, just put them out on a tray for 2 hours at least, and then just turn it off, let them cool, then put them in and mark them as baked. Okay, what that does is it cooks the starches. It'll make it much sweeter, but they're not going to cause that. 2 years later, we met him. He hadn't had one more stroke. Proving the prophecy. Can you prove it? Amen. Yes. Amen. You take his promises in faith and you do that. I've seen where there was this lady, she was dealing with, quite a few different health issues. And the doctors had told her, there's no way you're ever going to get off of this medication. And so she'd try one thing, try another, all kinds of diet-related things. We sat down with her. A week later, in our transit over to California, we get in the airport and here's this urgent message. She had left a voicemail. You gotta call me. So we called. We found out that as she was keeping track of all of her stats over that week, she went and gave them to the doctor. Didn't meet with the doctor, you know, obviously. She handed it to a nurse. He had called and left a message on her answer machine, said, "Hey, don't take any more of the medication." 20 minutes later, he called again and left another message. "Whatever you do, do not take any more medication in 1 week." That is what the spirit of prophecy will do. Do you understand what we have? We're told that it is the most solemn, most important message ever given to mortals. We are all mortal, correct?
Yes.
Is Satan working against this? Yes, he is. Satan is constantly pressing in the spurious to lead away from the truth. The very last deception of Satan will be to make of none effect the testimony of the Spirit of God. Where there is no vision, the people perish. Satan will work ingeniously in different ways and through different agencies to unsettle the confidence of God's remnant people in the true testimony. I know a gentleman, I actually worked with him some, that started with a little doubt. What ends up happening? Do you know anyone like that? I know others too, where there's this little doubt. Well, I don't know about this part. What happens? On down the road, what usually happens? they give up everything. He is constantly trying to pull us away from our testimony. In this fearful time, just before Christ is to come the second time, God's faithful preachers will have to bear a still more pointed testimony than was borne by John the Baptist. A responsible, important work is before them, and those who speak smooth things, God will not acknowledge as his shepherds. A fearful woe is upon them. I'm not here to give you smooth things. I'm sorry, I can't. I can't. You know, it's funny. Who are we likened to? We're supposed to be what John the Baptist did for Christ's first coming. We're doing for Christ's second coming, right? You know, Ellen White, she said that she is not a prophet, but that she is more than a prophet. You know that quote, right? I don't have to pull it up. John the Baptist had the same thing. Read about it. And that's actually part of the, dealing with the lesser light and the greater light. John the Baptist was the lesser light leading to what? Christ, the greater light. So there's in your study, you'll find that. We're going to be reading a little bit of Spirit of Prophecy, so I'm hoping that it's large enough for you. A theoretical knowledge of the truth is essential, but the knowledge of the greatest truth will not save us. Own knowledge must become practical. People, God's people, must not only know his will, but they must practice it. Many will be purged out from the number of those who know the truth because they are not sanctified by it. You know, in the 60s, I believe it was 50s or 60s, our church was called a cult. I'm sure some of you remember that. And then there was some massaging and... What does the Bible teach about perfecting our character? What does Christ say? It's a topic in our church, isn't it? I'm not here to preach on that. If we are not sanctified, what does sanctified mean? Being holy? If we're not being sanctified by the truth, then we're not holy, right? So we're to allow that truth to work in us, correct? You know, if we are a living testimony of what God has given, everything, if we're taking every point and following, not beating people over the head, I know because I grew up in the church, my sister got beat over the head, I know. I got aunts, cousins, where they consider themselves Seventh-day Adventists, but they don't go to church anymore. Okay? You understand what I'm saying? Because someone was too hard personally. Now here, I'm just sharing. I don't know anyone here. I might recognize a few people back from when I was around, but I don't know anyone. So don't take anything personally. Take it as what God has given to us. If you are living to your utmost, willing to sacrifice, willing to give up whatever it is, and we know you're coming up on this health expo, appetite is what? One of the strongest things that you have to deal with, right? It is the strongest thing. God will open doors. I've been in, who's been to Trader Joe's? Okay, you must have one around here. We shop Trader Joe's and Whole Foods, and I mean, there's certain things, a farmer's market. I've been in the line checking out at Trader Joe's, and God gave an appointment. You know, a divine appointment. Have you ever had those where someone asks a question and then, bam, you don't even remember what you said, but they're like, in just a couple minutes, they're like, I just prayed for this and you gave the answer. I'm so happy. Do you understand that? I've been walking through a park. Same thing. Yes, sometimes it's about the health aspect. Other times it's about the three angels' message. When I moved to Atlanta, I didn't know anything about the three angels' message. I mean, I knew, I've heard it, but I didn't actually know it. You should be able to speak that, correct? The health message was easy. But when we got down there, we started handing out great controversies. Actually, we were up in... You knew that you are one of the last areas in the Southern Union, the last areas that actually have a publishing program, correct? Literature evangelist, right? When I lived in Virginia, it had gone away back in 2003, 2004, I don't know exactly. And so now they're just independent. There weren't any. When we moved down to Atlanta, we had to go back up because our house hadn't sold. We actually were renovating and all kinds of stuff. So we went up and we were going to go camping up there, right next to West Virginia. We went camping, had our van packed with my nephews, niece. I mean, we had 9 people in a 7-passenger van. Oh, I shouldn't say that. But they were little, you know, double seat belt, 2 kids in 1 seat belt. Anyway, and full of tents and everything. Out in the middle of nowhere, 50 miles from a Walmart, much less a Trader Joe's. And driving back home, just had left, started driving. 65 and a 55. We were talking and having fun. You know, there was no one out there. My wife's like, oh, why did you speed? You know, she was upset, as most wives, as all wives should be. Now, let me say that. And he came up and I gave him the stuff. I'm praying, Lord, please help him not to see how many people we have, you know, double seatbelt and all that. Well, no, he didn't. He went on back and my wife turns to me, aren't you going to go back and talk to him? I'm like, you know, I'm from Virginia. You know, I don't know things. I'm so naive in some aspects. So I'm like, okay, and I said a prayer and I went back. And, you know, he didn't pull out his gun or anything. And we start talking. Well, he wouldn't let me off the ticket. He's like, well, I've set this, and if it goes over, I never, you know, consider letting you off. I'm like, fine. And, well, he started talking about, I don't even know how this happened. And this was a divine appointment. When you can't remember, usually it's a divine appointment. And he starts talking about the papacy. He started talking about all kinds of things. I'm like, man, this guy is, he knows what he's talking about. Where in the world is he getting this? And I'm like, so where are you learning this? And he goes to his back seat and pulls out the Great Controversy. And I was like, what? Where did you get that? And I'm like, that's an excellent book. You know, I hand them out, you know. Well, my father sold these. I didn't want to say like that, but, you know, I sort of was careful how I said it. And he's like, oh, my church, he was Baptist, and several other churches, other denominations, went together and bought cases of these to hand out. Wow. What in the world? What will happen if we don't give the message? Amen. The rocks are going to cry out. As we were building, yeah, our house sold and all that. As we were building in Atlanta, we had, they sent us the wrong floor. You know, we didn't have money. Working for the church, don't look for money, but look for everything provided. Does that make sense? Okay? They had sent the wrong floor. And So then they sent the right floor, but they hadn't picked up the old floor. And, you know, as you're building, then you got to move that old floor outside. And, you know, it was a big stack. And so we could work on the house because we wanted to get out of the city. Has anyone heard of anything about out of the cities? And the guy comes to pick it up after 2 months, and I'm out there helping him, you know, load up, and he looks, he's like, oh, what's that up the hill? I'm like, well, that's my water tank, BPA-free 500-gallon water tank. I pump water up there from solar, and it gravity feeds the house. And he's like, oh, so what are you doing to get ready for the time of no buy, no sell? Brothers and sisters, we don't know what is going on in the world. We have our blinders on. We're in our church, what have we been distracted with? You name it, we were distracted, right? I mean, this was a GC session where, yes, I was there. You had a tremendous amount of delegates showing up for a vote that is a distraction. Do you understand that?
Yes.
What's happening in the world? We're going to get to that. As we were in Atlanta, my wife, she had been inspecting, you know, she's Korean. She had been looking at world events, or I'm sorry, news on her CNN of Korea, so to speak. Okay, you know, it's their big news. And she had been noticing, and I believe it was 2011 at that time, a lot of things happening. And sometimes she would share them with me. Well, in the beginning of 2012, the first week or two, she came to me and she's like, David, look at this. In China, this is the second time, and it's hitting the main news, where this airport was closed for 2 hours, the second time, because of a large object hovering over the airport. She showed me a picture, and I'm like, I didn't know what to say. I grew up Adventist. I'm like, wow, that's interesting. Well, I mean, what do you say? That was on a Friday afternoon, you know, as we were getting, we've gotten things ready for Sabbath, and it was getting near the time where we start doing our welcoming in the Sabbath worship. You know about Sabbath reform, right? There's a few reforms that we've been given, and Sabbath is one of them. I grew up not keeping the Sabbath. In fact, I'm still trying to keep the Sabbath. Why? Because I want to. It's not a law for me. But if that's the final test, I want to be ready for that test. Does that make sense? So we studied about all. Anyway, that's another. An hour later, after she had said that, we sit down for worship. I open up, you know these newfangled devices, and I popped on Ellen G. White, and I'm like, what do y'all want to read? Well, whatever, just choose something. And so I chose. And here is what showed up. Fearful sights of a supernatural character will soon be revealed in the heavens. Huh. In token of the power of miracle-working demons. I had an answer. We had an answer. If you go on down and read, we know that this is what? Right before Christ's coming, right before everything happens. Yes. You know, I'm a country boy. My father was a peanut farmer until I was about 6 years old. Well, before I was born, he became the literary evangelist and then the leader. But I grew up on the farm because Fridays and Sundays, we would go and work the 100 acres of peanuts and corn. And so I grew up on the farm. Always, it followed us. We had a garden here, on a mountain, and then he found someone and grew corn down in the bottom. Well, when I get down to Atlanta, we're living in a apartment. I don't like the city. I never lived in the city. And I was kept looking for land somewhere. You know, our dream was to get out of the city. Of course, I hadn't studied into it at that time. And so it was like, where can we hide? You know what I mean, right? At first it's like, okay, where are we gonna hide? Well, there's nothing about hiding. There's nothing about hiding. Satan can find you. Well, there, he's behind the third bush on the left. You know what I'm saying? There's nothing about hiding. If you're getting out of the city to hide, stay where you are. Does that make sense? There's clear guidelines of why we get out, right? So we found an apartment that was 12 miles from work. I mean, Atlanta, so we're right at the Beltway. If you've ever been to Atlanta, the big spaghetti junction where 85 crosses, we are a mile from there. Right down the street was a strip joint. Alcohol, I mean, you name it. But God answered our prayers in this place because this apartment was clean and light. It was very difficult to find a light apartment, you know, where the sun shone in and it was, and no smell or very, very little. And when you look out, it was just trees. There was a nice place to walk. There was a pond. I mean, you felt like you were in a park, which was an answer to our prayers. The office comes to me and says, David, in 60 days from next week, your lease is up. You need to tell us by next week whether you're going to renew or not. And I'm like, what? I never rented or leased an apartment before. And man, can't we do it a month? No, 2 months, 60 days. I'm like, okay, well, I'll let you know next week. So Sunday, I'm praying, Lord, I don't know what to do. I typed up a letter saying that I'm not going to renew the lease. I signed it. I laid it on the counter. I knelt down and I said, Lord, if it's time for us to get out, you have to make it clear. You gave us this apartment. It was an answer to prayer. I'm not testing the Lord, right? I'm relying on His promises. I said, I'm not going to turn this in unless you make it clear that it's time for us to get out. I went into work the next day, and I don't know if you know how the union works. They have an executive committee that comes together and decides things for the office. I didn't know this. The next day I go into work about noon, my supervisor comes in and he's like, David, you never guess what happened. The executive committee voted to move the office from Decatur to Peachtree Corners, about 23 miles, which opened up a totally new area of where I could, I mean, because where it was, it just wasn't possible. I mean, you're talking an hour and a half drive to be in the country. Was it an answer to my prayer? You bet it was. What happened after that? Well, we found land, and God put a stamp on it. We didn't have money. We got 5.65 acres for $12,500. It was $108,000. So I can tell you hair-raising things what happened of how we bought all of our cabinets for $860, and the ones that are in the kitchen are $416 worth. Well, we've wheeled one in, so it's $430 worth. And I'll tell you, it's an amazing kitchen. We didn't know until we started unpacking the boxes and building them 6 months after we got them. We had the cabinets before we built the house. God led us from point to point to point. I used to build. I don't know if you know George Pendleton. I worked for George. And if you say, David Koliadko, he's like, who? He called me Arv. I don't know why. There was some program back then called and there was some Arvin, or I don't know. Anyway, he thought I looked like him, but I worked for George. I worked in this area. So building a house was something that I knew how to do. And working at the office, I knew I couldn't go and watch the well drilling, for one thing. The other things I didn't worry about, but well, I mean, they could drill 50 feet and tell you it was 200. I mean, you know what I'm saying. They can. So I'm like, Lord, this is yours, because I can't take off from work to watch. So they were drilling and they said, hey, we're done. And I think it was like Wednesday. And my wife had called me earlier that day, and we had built a little deck because the land was covered with trees. And so we had to clear them. And so we were going out there working all the time that we could, but we needed a place to eat our lunch. And so we built a 6-foot by 10-foot deck right next to the ground, Korean style, sort of, you know, where you just go and sit and cook your food, sit, and then go work again. Well, in our going out and, let me see the time, the kids almost got bit by a immature black copperhead, okay? And so my wife calls me, as they're drilling the well, she's like, hey, I think we should put some mulch under there so that no animals will be under there, you know, because you walk up to it, it's like this. You know, if there's something under it, it'll get you because you don't see it. Does that make sense? And so I'm like, well, I don't know about mulch because they might like to burrow in that. I think we should get some crusher run, you know, something real fine rocks and put under there really good so there's no place for them to hide. Does that make sense? And so I'm like, well, when we build the road, when we get the road put in, I'll wheelbarrow it down there. It's right next to the creek that we have running through. Well, on Friday, which we don't work on Fridays, we work a 4-day work week, long days, I go there and I meet the well driller. I hand them the check. They just met me in the cul-de-sac. They had pulled out all their equipment before, gave them the check, sight unseen. I went down there, and let me tell you, we got water 20 plus gallons a minute, and the water was 23 feet from the where. I mean, I could see the water. I took my tape measure. I mean, 20, and it was dry. And yet, I mean, you know, we're in a drought then. So the Lord blessed us. I mean, I could get a cup and get my water if I needed to, right? But I go and look at this. And I hope you can see this. This is what I saw. Well, I hope this is what I saw. When they drilled, all of the millings or whatever had run, and they tried to block it, but it went around anyway, and it actually went two ways, and it completely covered underneath. Amen. You see, the side that we go on, this side, the right side, it had this much rock all around. It had encased the cinder blocks. And on the other side, which we don't walk on, it was basically exactly even with the deck. Now, let me tell you, I had some serious tears in my eyes. I didn't have to lift a finger. God heard our discussion. Why? Because we were willing to step out and follow all of His promises. There you see it a little better how the cinder block, I mean, it's got that much block sticking out. It had that much rock just under there. So did we have to worry about things burying there? No, it was like cement after that. How long do I have? Now, I know that the spirit of prophecies, we're told that an hour and 20 minutes is not a long sermon. So, I'm sorry. We didn't have money. We were... Since I grew up and building, I knew that a basement was the most expensive thing. Then what? A crawl space and then slab. You know what I'm talking about. So I was sitting there, we didn't have money, and I'm going through, okay, what can we do? It was getting close to excavation time. And I didn't know what to tell them. They had almost cleared the land, and I didn't even have to pay for them to clear it. In fact, they gave me stuff back just for the logs that they took off, and I got a lot of firewood too. And we got our 500-gallon BPA-free water tank, and I had to bring it back up there. And so I brought my van and rented a trailer, and I'm like, Yunjong, I need your help because it's dark and I need to unload it up there. Even before we had a house, we had a water tank coming. And so she goes with me. We go up there, and as we're coming back, I'm like, I'm supposed to tell the excavator what to do. And last Monday, as we were watching the sermon, the Lord convicted me that I was to step out as Noah, step out as Abraham. He was convicting me, build a basement. Why? You know why you're supposed to be out in the country, right? Why? Because there's going to be people that will be leaving the city that are accepting the three angels' message, and they will not have... So, refugees, right? So we were thinking, oh, if we had a basement, and the Lord convicted me on that. And so I said, as we're driving back home, it was about 9, the kids had put themselves to sleep, done their worship, all of this. And I said, I've been convicted of this. And she says, well, we just need to pray. It's done. We're making the decision. We're going to build a basement. So we prayed. I'm like, well, I still would like a confirmation. Can we ask for confirmations? Yes. Get home, take a shower, get in bed, and before we go to sleep, we usually read just a little bit of something as husband and wife. And I open up a book that was sitting there beside the bed. I don't know if you've heard of Another Ark to Build by W.D. Frazee. Yep. Okay. This is what I turned to. And this is the first thing my eyes laid on. I wasn't trying to look for a confirmation. Let me tell you, all the times that this happened, I wasn't trying. Oh, let me find. It wasn't like that. Now God wants not only every church and every institution to be your city of refuge. He wants you personally and your individual home. Did you know your home was to be a city of refuge? Let me read that in the Ministry of Healing, page 354. Our homes should be places of refuge. And then it goes on and gives some more. A place of refuge. Oh, sorry. I'm jumping ahead. Fast forward, we had built the house, we were working on it, and we had a ton of stuff in the basement to try. It was over the winter time that we were doing this. We were building it. We hired out very few things, and it was just stuffed with all of the materials for upstairs. And I'm sitting there looking at it in January, wow, we couldn't have done this without a basement. Maybe the Lord, what, doubt crept in. Maybe the Lord got us to do this because of this. We couldn't have all this stuff outside. The mice would be in it. You know what I'm... You can't do that. That week, as I looked at the basement full, that's what I kept thinking. I didn't speak this to my wife. And then one morning, as I was getting ready to do my personal devotion, I prayed, Lord, whatever it is that you need to tell me, whatever it is that you need to show me. If I need to share it, or if it's for me, or my family. And that is what I turned to. A place of refuge. The Lord wouldn't tell us to make a place of refuge if there were no refugees going to come to it. Friends, it seems to me that we need to do all our work with that view in our minds. The coming of the refugees, they are coming. God knows that they are coming, whether we get ready for them or not. And on that same page, when the refugees come, will you have a place for them? And will there be something in the garden and in the granary? Or will you say, oh, I'm so sorry. The reason I made this point, do not doubt what God has led and confirmed. If He led you a certain way, there's a reason for it. There is no way that we would have not built a basement after the first confirmation. But then when doubt came in, that's what God gave me. I mentioned that to my wife and she said, I was thinking that this last week too. Don't doubt God's leading. Now, of course, you know why. It is no time now for God's people to be fixing their affections or laying up their treasure in the world. And of course, the cities are to be worked from outposts. Said the messenger of God, shall not the cities be warned? Yes, not by God's people living in them, but by their visiting them, to warn them of what is coming upon the earth. We need an experience, right? Remember the 10 virgins. The ones that were not ready did not have the experience, right? We need the experience to where we will not turn. Does that make sense? We need to know what we stand on. And we need to know the message. The message and what our aim is. We're supposed to be giving this to the world. And the world is finding it on their own because we're not doing our job well. I mean, I'm not doing all I can. I'm trying. We're trying. We're being led by point to point. We're going to run through a few things, and we're going to be very quick about this, but I wanted to make my battery's 10%. Okay. Jesus comes out of the water in Luke 3:21. Now, we're sort of jumping now, so stay with me. And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea. So, Jesus came out of the water, right? The beast comes out of the water. Jesus' ministry lasts 3.5 years, okay? And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months, 3.5 years, okay? Jesus would receive a wound and die, then be raised and draw all men to him. And I saw one of his heads as it was wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. Those who place themselves under God's control to be led and guided by Him will catch the steady trend of events ordained by Him to take place. Now, I know that some people might say, oh, you're just a, what did they call, you know, you keep, yeah, conspiracy theory, all these different things. Alarmists, that's it. Before it was conspiracy theory, correct? They can't say that anymore. You know that, right? That's gone. Now, those who cannot see the signs of the times in this wicked and adulterous generation will be found with those who perish under the plagues poured from the vials of God's wrath. So, are we supposed to be looking at these things? Amen. Not to be an alarmist, but to know that our loving Savior is coming soon. Amen. And that soon, before that happens, there are some things that's got to happen, right? Are we getting ready for that? Yes. If just say this. If in 2 months you're not able to buy and sell, say 2 months later, I'm just throwing this out. It's not something that I've thought about. I'm just throwing it out. In 2 months, do you have enough to survive? What was the reason to get out of the cities? Yeah, I know, in change of environment, but then what does it say? It says to grow sustenance or provisions because the time of no buy, no sell will be a very serious time. Okay, does that make sense? So, if you look at what we've been given, yeah, if I got out 20 years ago, man, I'm sitting there, when is all this going to happen? But looking at the current events, as we were going to brush through real quickly, we need to have that in mind. Amen. Nothing my family buys, I can't think of anything, because every time we look at something to get, it is to keep that in mind. Amen. To be ready. Is it going to help us in that time? Are we going to be able to help those who are fleeing the cities? Are we going to be able to use that to give a loud cry, to give our minds the things that we need so that we can give the loud cry, right? Those are the things that we're supposed to be looking for, right? Okay. Pope Francis, religion should not be confined to personal conscience. Doesn't sound too bad, does it? Whew. All Northern Europe seemed about to be brought under the tyranny of Rome. It was the armies of Sweden that enabled Germany to turn the tide of popish success, to win toleration for the Protestants, Calvinist as well as Lutherans, and to restore liberty of conscience. Okay? Is that totally wrong? I mean, totally opposite what he just said, right? Liberty of conscience to those countries that had accepted the Reformation. Nothing is dearer or more fundamental. The Constitution of the United States guarantees liberty of conscience. The absurd and erroneous doctrines and ravings of the in defense of liberty of conscience are a most pestilential error, a pest of all others most to be dreaded in the state. So, that's one thing. Are we a conspiracy theorist? No, because it's coming right out of their mouths, right? Let's see. Liberty of conscience, which has cost so great a sacrifice, will no longer be respected. Do we have the liberty of conscience now? What did the Supreme Court vote recently? Do we have liberty of conscience to where we can... freedom of speech, I mean, no. Are they being... 20 years ago, people would say, he's just conspiracy theorist, right? We need to open our eyes. We are very, very, very close. Personally, I have spoken with many people, and they said, we have but a few short months. I mean, we're told that. We have but a few short months. The Protestants of the United States will be foremost in stretching hands across the Gulf to grasp the hands of spiritualism, clasping the hands with Roman power. This country will follow in the steps of Rome and trampling on the rights of conscience. Okay. Then you have the Pope asking forgiveness of Catholic persecution to the Waldenses. What does it say? The Roman Church now presents a fair front to the world, covering with apologies her record of horrible cruelty. She has clothed herself in Christ-like garments, but is unchanged. Let none deceive themselves. The papacy that Protestants are now so ready to honor is the same that ruled the world in the days of Reformation. Maybe you've heard that quote. Let's go on, because I don't want to keep us too long. While the Protestant world is by her attitude making concessions to Rome, let us arouse to comprehend the situation and view the contest before us in its true bearing. Let the watchmen now lift up their voice and give the message which is present truth for this time. Let us show the people we are where we are in prophetic history. Can we do that?
Yes.
We need to. We need to be able to lay it out, right? Did you know that we're told that the showing of the prophecy, laying that prophecy out, is the way many will come to the truth. Does that make sense? If you can lay it out for someone, they can't deny it, right? It's up to the Holy... I mean, yes, we have to let, what, the Holy Spirit convict, but we are to give the truth. Are we close, people? As a storm approaches, a large class who have professed faith in the third angel's message but have not been sanctified through obedience to the truth abandon their position and join the ranks of the opposition. And we know that they're going to be our most, what? Strongest persecutors, right? Here we have some of the leading men grasping the hands, right? I don't need to go back to what happened with the evangelical. You know that, right? Tony Palmer, right? Now, all that stuff. I don't need to go back there. Let's go on. We're told of what the Jesuits were founded for and what their purpose is, right? Does everyone know this part? There was no crime too great for them to commit, no deception too base for them to practice, no disguise too difficult for them to assume. Vowed to perpetual poverty and humility, it was their studied aim to secure wealth and power, to be devoted to the overthrow of Protestantism and the reestablishment of the papal supremacy. Okay. Pope sends greetings for U.S. Christian Unity event. Dear brothers and sisters, division is a wound. Wow. That made my ears perk up. Did it yours?
Yes.
In the body of the Church of Christ, and we do not want this wound to remain open. Division is the work of the father of lies. Whew. Wow. The father of discord, who does everything possible to keep us divided. Wow. These quotes, I want to get down a little bit more, so here we go. The Jubilee. Has anyone looked at the Jubilee?
Yes.
Point four, I have chosen the date of the 8th of December because of its rich meaning in the recent history of the church. In fact, I will open the holy door. Who opens up? Who can open a holy door? Yeah, the Bible says only Jesus can open that door, right? And no man can shut it, right? Okay, you know what that is. On the 50th anniversary of the closing of the Second Vatican Ecumenical Council, what is ecumenism? Joined together, right? You see that reaching across, right? December 8 is when it ended 50 years ago. Okay? It will go from December 8 until November 20, 2016. And what he wants this year to happen is the bringing together. Did you know that he said that he only has a few years?
Yes.
If he's saying that and he's doing all these things, he is very blatant about this, right? All of this. We need to be on guard. We need to be getting ready. Point 20. It would not be out of place at this point to recall the relationship between justice and mercy. Such a vision, however, has not infrequently led to legalism or his part. Jesus speaks several times of the importance of faith over and above the observance of the law. Huh. Wow. I don't know where he got this, but you know where he's going, right? What's more important? Faith above law. Point 15. In his holy year, we will look forward to the experience of opening our hearts to those living on the outermost fringes of society. Okay, who's living on the outermost fringes of the society? May their cry become our own, and together may we break down the barriers of indifference, that too often reign supreme and mask our hypocrisy and egoism. So, he's saying we need to accept them where they are and not tell them where they are. Does that make sense? He doesn't want to have any difference. Basically, everyone, correct? It shows up more on point 23. Almost done. Okay. Point 23. There is an aspect of mercy that goes beyond the confines of the church. If you go down there, so that we might know and understand one another better, may it eliminate every form of closed-mindedness and disrespect and drive out every form of violence and discrimination. Now, I agree in some aspects of this, right? As you should. We shouldn't be discriminating. No, that's not what we're talking about. But when he says this, he's not wanting us to be fundamentalist. What is a fundamentalist? In fact, you know that they train police officers how to deal with fundamentalists. Are we fundamentalists? Yes. They consider us a threat. Why are we a threat? Not what they think. We have the true message. We have the truth, right? Okay, you know about the big environmental thing, right? On point 71, he talks about how the Sabbath was a rest, and then he goes on and talks about the Jubilee, the year of all of that, right? And then at the end, he says, Sunday, like the Jewish Sabbath. So he's saying, we need to get back to this. You know that he's coming to Pennsylvania, Philadelphia. And they actually said that this could be the largest event ever. They are expecting upwards of 2 million people to attend. Where are we, people? I'm excited. Aren't you? Things, we know that they're going to happen very rapidly. It's been pretty rapid, but could it happen a lot more rapidly? I do believe that we have but a few short months. And if we don't, praise the Lord, we have more time to do what we should have been doing. I mean, what I should have been doing. I'm preaching to myself here. Are we ready for Jesus to come? Did he give us a tremendous message given to us mortals 100 years ago? We're still here. Man, would the prophets love to be in our shoes right now? We need to be on our knees, searching in our hearts for anything. Your prayer needs to be daily. Lord, am I right with you? What do I need to do? Read the spirit of prophecy. Read it. Read it with the Bible. You know, you read the in the Conflict of Ages series, read the Bible that goes with that, and then read the Conflict of Ages. We need to be ready. And I'm telling you, the next time we meet, I don't want it to be here. I do not. I know how the Lord has led in our lives. When he gives me confirmation, affirmation, whatever you want to call it. No, I guess it's confirmation. I know that he's giving it to me. Make it an experience for you. Ask for that experience. Pray for it. We're going home soon. And let it be everyone in this room. And let us bring many outside of here. I want to hear, well done, good and faithful servant. If God opens a door, all of his biddings are his enablings. Prepare. Be ready. But just like Nehemiah, expect what? The Sambalats, right? Oh, you're building a wall that the foxes can break down. Don't be discouraged. Expect discouragement. If you're not having that, you know you're not doing something right. Does that make sense? Expect to be having opposition. Just make yourself right with God every day.